now, today's adventure of Outer Scope 2, landing at the seaport. Eleanor, Edgar, and Cynthia have learned that a clue to the missing gold medallion may be on an old sailing ship in New York Harbor. Looking for a place to land Outer Scope, they approach one of the piers. Will they make it?
There's the World Trade Twin Towers. Gee, look how crowded in it is. Maybe this wasn't such a great idea after all.
Why not?
Where'll we land?
What about right on the shore?
What shore? There isn't any. Everything comes right down to the water, the buildings, everything.
Still, we have to find someplace to land, and quickly.
We sure can't land on any of those buildings.
What about one of the piers?
I guess so, but they're so small.
Oh, that's okay. I'll steer it in. You pick up here and just guide us in.
I'll cut back to fuel.
Great.
You know, if we miss this pier and hit the water, we could all drown.
We won't miss it. That's all there is to it.
Which way, Cynthia? Which way?
A little more left. That's it. Over to the right a little. Great. We're coming in too fast. Pull back to the power. To the left. To the left. To the right. Slow down. Slow down. Oh, no, I think we're gonna miss it. Cut the power. Cut the power.
We made it.
See, yes, we did, didn't we?
Oh, that sure wasn't water we landed on. Hey, good job, you two.
Gracias.
Hey, let's go see what's out there.
Wow, look at this.
Look at all the pretty old ships.
And all the people, too. It's like a big party out here.
Great, let's go. Hey, guys. Nice landing.
Thanks a lot.
Welcome to New York.
Why, thank you. Thanks a lot.
Thank you.
Hi.
Hello there, how are you?
Oh, thank you.
Ship. What kind is it?
It's a packet ship.
It's called the Pioneer.
Oh.
It's an old fishing ship.
Yeah, men used to go out on it. In the Navy, they used it, too. It was used in the 1800s.
Yeah. My mother came here to buy some fish. Then when we found out the fish market was closed, my uncle brought us here, and then I ended up seeing the sea.
Oh, well, maybe you can catch some fish. There might be some fish here.
What's your dog's name?
My dog's name is Yogi.
Can I pet it?
Sure.
Oh, thanks.
Sure. Here, come on, Yogi. Come on, get petted.
It's
here.
It's very big.
Come on. He's not too big. He's a nice dog.
It's okay.
Dog.
He won't bite.
No, he won't bite. He's a nice doggy.
Yeah?
Oh,
okay.
Good doggy. Right.
Hello.
Here, put Yogi.
Ooh. We're looking for a big ship. Have you seen a ship called the Peking?
Well, no, we're kind of visitor. No, we're just visiting here. We don't know any.
We don't know any of the ships.
No,
so.
Sorry.
Is it nice on the ship?
Yeah.
Oh, good. Hey, there's one over there, too. Oh, yeah. Oh, they're all over. That's wonderful. Which is your favorite ship?
I can see another one.
Oh, yeah. Oh, thank you, Brandy. Oh, yeah. That's terrific.
You're my friend.
What? Oh, yeah, this is Angelina. What?
Are you my friend?
Yeah. Sure, we're all friends.
This is my old pal.
Wonderful.
Yeah.
I just wish Willie and Henry were here.
Me too. I wonder what they're doing right now.
Really neat circus.
Oh, that's a llama, Henry.
Hmm.
Oh, hey.
Hi, kids.
Hello.
Great circus.
Yeah, really great circus.
Glad you're having a good time. Stay as long as you like.
Gee, thanks.
Oh.
Okay, well, see you later, kids.
Bye.
Bye.
What a lot of fun, huh, Willie?
But I keep thinking about your sister and the others. I wonder what they're doing now.
South Australia, all the way you'll roll in Kings to Maeve away and haul away. All the way you'll hear me sing, we're bound for South Australia. We're bound for China or Japan to Maeve away and haul away. We'll make our fortunes if we can, we're bound for South Australia. All the way you'll roll in Kings to Maeve away and haul away. All the way you'll hear me sing, we're bound for South Australia.
Faraway places. We were going to check out that ship, the Peking, remember?
See, right.
Yeah, what are we waiting for? Let's get going.
Yeah.
Wow, look at that one.
Wonder which one it is.
That's it, the Peking.
Next time, the clue aboard the Peking.
What do you want to know about yourself? What do you want to know about yourself?
Suppose for a minute that the entire world was suddenly without color. It might be difficult to tell an apple from an orange. All the flavors of ice cream would look alike. And traffic lights could be very confusing. Fortunately, color is everywhere. But fortunately, color is everywhere. Color is there to help us see and to make seeing more fun. Did you ever wonder if everybody else sees color the way you do? Well, except for a few people who are colorblind, we all see the grass as green, dandelions as yellow, the sky as blue. But color is not just yellow, green, and blue. Color has meaning. People use color as a kind of language. For example, all over the world, you could be in Paris, Peking, or Peoria, Illinois. And everywhere, red stands for stop, and green stands for go. And sometimes, the same color can have different meanings to different people. Sometimes in movies and plays in this country, when an actor wears black, he is the villain. And the actor in white is the good guy. But there are other ways to look at it. In the Asian art of Aikido, a black belt stands for higher achievement than a white belt. So, even though we all agree on what colors look like, we don't always agree on what they mean. Nowhere is this more of a problem than when it comes to the color of humans. When people try to attach meaning to the shades of human skin color, to say that one shade is better than another, well, it just doesn't make sense. They might as well say they like the light squares on a checkerboard better than the dark squares. Or the dark-colored rocks are better than light-colored rocks. Without the one, you can't appreciate the other. All of us need all of us for a colorful world.
A slave ship at sea, 1839.
This slave ship is creepy.
Shh, they'll hear us.
I wonder where Sinke is.
Get out of these chains.
Shh. It's me, Sinke. Don't move. I knew when I saw the both of you in the galley that I could trust you. You have the look of free people. Like me. Where's the key?
Down the rope next to the hatch.
Been selling lives much too long.
And who shall stop me?
You are looking at a free man, not a slave in chains.
And a short-lived freedom it will be.
How does it feel to be a captive? You have done this to many of my people.
I'll give you all the gold on the ship.
I should throw you to the sharks, like you have done to many of us.
Please don't. I'll do anything you want.
If you want your life spared, You will guide us to a friendly port. And from there, we shall get help and a way to get back to Africa.
Yes, anything.
Rise up, my brothers. Today, we are free. The ship is ours. No people were meant to be slaves. We shall not be sold like animals in some strange country. Our families will rejoice when they see us, the master of our own lives. Rise up! We are free!
Sinkate was picked up by the U.S. Navy, and he and his fellow Africans were put in jail. But Sinkate didn't give up. He kept on fighting for his freedom in the U.S. courts, all the way to the Supreme Court. After 4 long years, Sinkate won his case and with his friends, finally returned to Africa.
And I'm visiting in Tennessee. Today I'll give my pet Bo and Nigel a rest and go off with Cousin Waleen and Uncle Jim.
Okay, everybody, eat up. We want to get down there before the auction starts.
You better not move a muscle.
Well, you can move a muscle, but you better not pull your earlobe or scratch your head or you'll be done bought yourself a cow or a hog.
Are we going to go on the patrol car?
Yes, we are.
You ever use your gun, Uncle Jim?
Well, not really. We do more preventative work around here than most or than action work. Not like you guys in New York.
I don't live in New York.
Oh, yeah, New Jersey. Sorry about that. Guess we'd better get going.
Okay, I hope everybody will have a good day now.
Car 410.
410, go ahead.
I got a 1040 at number 28 Orchard Street. See Mrs. Parker. Possible prowler on the premises.
Isn't that the Mrs. Parker?
Yeah, the same. But you better check it out.
10-4. Better get moving. This Mrs. Parker calls in every other day. She's always got some problem. We better see what it is this time. Your kid's waiting in the car. It may not be anything, but I've got to check it out.
Oh, I'm so glad you're here, Sergeant Coleman. It's a burglar. I know it's a burglar.
Okay, now, where did you hear the noise?
Come right with me.
Kid, this is fun. Maybe we should get out and take a look.
I don't know. Daddy said for us not to leave the car. He might need us.
Come on. Okay.
Besides, we better stand by anyway.
Huh? Eddie, don't.
Okay, Miss.
Come on.
Don't worry about a thing. We've got it under control. Right on.
Keep your head down. What do you think's happening?
I don't know. Maybe it's a burglar.
Don't let him get away now.
Probably an animal.
What would it be doing in the house?
Looking for food, of course.
It's in the bathroom. It's a burglar. I just know it's a burglar.
It might be a bird.
Kids? Eddie, what are you doing out of the car?
Just looking.
Well, never mind. Come on, I've got a little job for you to do.
Me?
Yes.
Can I come?
No, you wait here. Right in here, Eddie. Eddie's the expert here.
Can you imagine a real snake in my bathroom?
Ooh,
what do you think, Eddie? You think he's poisonous? We'll have to kill him? Or...
No, I know this kind of snake.
Kill him, kill him.
It's a rat snake. I'll need a box and some gloves.
Wait just a minute, let me see if I can find him.
I'll just put him in a box and we can take him out to the field and let him go.
Whatever you think, Eddie, it'll be just fine.
Here you are. I'm sorry it took so long. Hurry up.
We'll have him in nothing flat, Miss Parker.
If the snake gets excited,
hurry up.
It might bite a little, but it's not poisonous.
Kill it.
He'll get lost in that box.
I wanted to have plenty of room, Eddie.
Well, that's the best I could do.
Nice little snake.
Good boy, Eddie.
Be careful. Don't let him get away. Hurry up. Hurry up.
We've got him now, Miss Fox. Certainly have. Okay, Eddie. Good boy.
What happened?
Nothing. Did you catch the burglar?
No, there was no burglar.
What was it?
Snake.
What kind?
Rat snake.
Is that poisonous?
No, of course not.
Show you about how we handle livestock here on Monday on our regular sale day. Just step right on up here. Sale always begins about 1 o'clock, and then we bring them through this chute up here on your right, as you can see, into what we call the auction ring, where we have the sale. Now, if you fellas will have a seat up there on that end while we'll show you how the livestock auction operates, okay? Just make yourself comfortable.
Let's go to work.
Oh boy, this is fun. Walena says the auction is very important in this town. I can't imagine how they understand what the auctioneer is saying. Oh, wow, that man just bought a cow by scratching his nose. I better be careful. Boy, the way my mom reacted when I brought Nigel home. I wonder what she'd say if I brought a cow home.
Eddie's adventure in Tennessee continues next time.
This is Woody the Spoon to give you some clues about the kind of bread that people use. They all start with plain old flour. You can sweeten it up or make it sour. You can make it from corn or wheat or rye. You can bake it in the oven or let it fry. 'Cause bread is bread, that's what I'm getting at. Short, long, or sliced, puffed up, or flat. Any way you make it, people love to try it. 'Cause bread is a part of everyone's diet.
We got baked bread, fried bread. We got toasted, boiled, and dried bread. We got bread in a box, bread in a can. Different kinds of bread from many different lands. We got bread.
Everybody eats some kind of bread.
We got bread.
Everyone has their own special bread.
Everybody eats some kind of bread. We got big bread, small bread. We got short, fat, skinny, and tall bread. We got bread in so many colors and hues. Sometimes it makes it hard to choose. We got bread.
Everybody eats some kind of bread.
We got bread.
Everyone has their own special bread.
Everybody eats some kind of bread.
Special bread.
Everybody eats some kind of bread. We got baked bread, fried bread.
We got
toasted, boiled, and dried bread. We got bread. bread in a box, bread in a can. Different kinds of bread from many different lands. We got bread,
everybody eats some kind of
we
bread.
We got bread,
everyone has their own special bread.
Everybody eats some kind of bread.
Well, I just feel kind of funny. I won't know nobody there.
Don't be crazy. You know me and my brother. Besides, you've never been to my house before. All my cousins are coming and some friends you never met. Hurry up. I'll wait downstairs.
It's just...
What?
I'll be the only black person there.
How would you feel if you were the only one at a party who was different?
I was in a country house and I was the only black person there. It was okay, but I was kind of scared that nobody was going to be my friend. I'd try to make friends the best I could.
I wouldn't feel anything as long as I had fun.
It wouldn't bother me. I like meeting new people.
How would you feel? Adventure of Outer Scope 2, The Clue Aboard the Peking.
Bound for China or Japan to me, either way and haul away will make
a Eleanor, Edgar, and Cynthia are having so much fun at the old seaport that they've almost forgotten what they came here for.
Either way and haul away you'll hear me sing, we're bound for South Australia.
Four-way places. We were going to check out that ship, the Peking, remember?
See, right.
Yeah, what are we waiting for? Let's get going.
Yeah.
Wow, look at that one.
Wonder which one it is.
That's it, the Peking.
Wow, I can't believe it. We actually found it.
Yeah. Hey, there's the gangplank. Let's go.
Hold on there. What's your hurry?
She's been here all these years. It's for certain she's not going anywhere now.
Yes, sir. We know, sir. Can we come on aboard?
Stop sirring me. Name's Hatch, Julian Hatch. Only name I got, and I like it just fine. What's yours?
Edgar. My name's Edgar.
And mine is Cynthia. And this is Eleanor. And can we please go aboard the Peking?
Don't see why not. That's why she's here. Come aboard.
Oh, really? Oh, great! Let's go!
How do we know what to look for? Maybe we could ask him.
Yeah, but then we'd have to tell him about the medallion.
That's true. Oh, I wish I knew what to do.
Look at her, mates. She was marvelously strong in every respect. Off Cape Horn, she did 11 knots with her in a full gale, carrying all three courses and lower top gallant
sail. Maybe we could just ask to see the log.
We'd probably be better off trusting him.
I don't know. He seems okay, but...
Hey!
You kids look like a gang of mutineers. Follow me below decks. You are now in the sail locker. Now, the sailmaker is one of the most important men on the ship.
Well, if we trusted him, at least he could do a lot more for us. He'd know the kind of things we should be looking for.
And probably just where to look.
Okay, let's have it. What are you kids up to?
Oh, we're sorry, sir. It's just that...
Well, we really came here to look for something, and we just don't know how to go about it.
Just what might you be looking for?
Well,
maybe I can help you find it.
Our friend's great-great-grandfather, Sailor Bill, once sailed on the Peking and was lost at sea.
Well, here's the crew's quarters. You know, you might have bunked right here. But you're not looking to find him aboard her now, are you?
Oh, no. But he had an old gold medallion and chain, and we wondered if anything might have been recorded about that after he was lost at sea.
Ah, I see. It's an old treasure you're looking for. Well, let's go up to the forecastle deck and check the ship's log and see what we can find, huh? Now, just about when did all of this take place?
Well, let's see. What was it Mr. Cuffy said?
Well, He said it was a new ship, I think.
That's right. The ship went to China.
And then there was a big flood.
Good fix, mate. Good fix. That'll help us a lot. Let's see. That should put us somewhere right about in here. Yes, here's the flood. June 8th, 1889. Hong Kong Harbor. It was 1 week since the flood, and the seas are calm enough to embark.
Oh, that must be the same voyage.
Let me see. June 10th, 1889, 2 days out of Hong Kong, two crewmen, Bill Topper and Jim Duncan, lost at sea last night. Very odd. The Chinese sailmaker Chun Li says he alerted Giles to possible trouble just the day before. What could it all mean? I will probably never know. That's it, kids.
Is that all?
You sure that's it?
There must be more. I just know there is.
I guess that's it. There isn't any more.
Boy, I was sure we'd find out something here about Sailor Bill.
Well, it doesn't look that way.
Aha, that's it.
What?
There is another entry, but not in this log. I remember now. It was made years later when the ship was in port right here in New York.
Where?
Now, hold your horses. Let's see. Should be somewhere along in this one. Here it is. First mate's entry. One incident of note during my watch this night. A seaman came aboard looking for the Chinese sailmaker Chun Li. Said he sailed with him aboard this ship some years before and left something of value with him. He seemed rather agitated on learning Chun Li was no longer crewing aboard our vessel. He did calm down somewhat on learning that Li had opened a sail-making shop nearby in Chinatown and could be reached there. Unfortunately, I could not give him the address, not knowing it myself. He thanked me nonetheless and asked that if I saw Li before he did, to please tell him Sailor Bill was looking for him.
He didn't die.
I'm so glad. I just knew he hadn't.
Sailor Bill, I take it, is one of the two men who went overboard?
That's right, Julian. It's his medal we're looking for.
And the something of value that he left with Chun Li, the sailmaker, was naturally...
The medallion, of course.
But how will we find this man, Chun Li? He probably died long ago.
Well, maybe so, but sailmaking is a fine craft passed on from father to child. It just still might be a Chun Li, the sailmaker, in Chinatown.
Looks like that's our next move, Julian.
Looks like it, Cynthia.
Chinatown, here we come. Boy, are we in trouble.
Talk about a needle in a haystack. Now what?
Excuse me. Yeah. We're looking for the family of a sailmaker named Chun Li, who lived here 65 years ago.
Sailmaker? 65 years ago?
Uh-huh.
Good luck, Jack.
Next time, at the circus.
What do you want to know about yourself? What do you want to know about
a combination of instruments and sounds that come from Puerto Rico. And yet, there are parts of this music that come from many places. The bongo drums come from Africa. The guitar is from Spain. And the maracas are part of the culture of the Taino Indians, early settlers of the island now called Puerto Rico. All of these instruments have come together to make the sounds of Puerto Rican music. And all of these musicians are Puerto Ricans. Where is Puerto Rico? It's an island, 1,000 miles from Miami, Florida, and nearly 2,000 miles from New York City. Who are the Puerto Ricans? As far as we know, the Arawaks and later the Taínos were among the first inhabitants of Puerto Rico. The Taínos were the first to plant crops on the island. They grew and used sugarcane, tobacco, corn, and rubber trees. The Taínos had a relaxed, productive life on their green island, which they called Boriquén. The peaceful life of the Taínos is still celebrated in the national anthem of Puerto Rico. While looking for India, Columbus landed on the island of Boriquén. Without asking the Taínos, Columbus claimed the island for Spain. The Spanish looked upon Puerto Rico as a source of riches, mainly gold, to take back to Spain. They even changed the name of the island. They called it Puerto Rico, which in Spanish means rich port. The Spanish turned the Taínos' tobacco and sugarcane farms into large food factories called plantations. And they brought Africans as slaves to help uncover the gold. But there was very little gold to be found in Puerto Rico, so Africans also worked on the plantations. As time went by, other people came to Puerto Rico from all parts of the world. They married and blended with the Taínos, the Spanish, and the Africans to form the many different cultures and shades of skin and hair color that we see in Puerto Rico today. After a treaty between Spain and the United States, Puerto Rico became a possession of the United States. As a result, all Puerto Ricans became U.S. citizens. Many people were attracted to the warm and green island of Puerto Rico. However, industry slowed down and work became hard to find. Many Puerto Ricans decided to leave the island. They came mostly to New York and Chicago looking for jobs. These newcomers flew by plane in a few hours, unlike the European immigrants who traveled several weeks by steamship. Puerto Ricans have strong ties to their culture and speak Spanish as well as English. Puerto Ricans have much to teach us besides their language and ways of life. They have lived for many centuries in harmony with all their physical and cultural variety.
Mariana Presete, Puerto Rico, 1868.
You better find that book, old man. Quick. Where's the book?
Wait. Here. I found it. See the long hours I have worked? But I gave you my book, and you threw it into the gully.
You should be ashamed of yourself. I saw you throw his workbook away.
Who are you? What is your name?
I am Mariana Bracetti.
You should be home with your husband, not braying about some old man.
Look at him. He has spent his whole life working the fields. He is worn and broken into the earth. He can be your father. Can you not see before you a man who has done nothing harmful to you?
Quiet. I don't want to hear anymore. You speak like a revolutionary. I will have to arrest you.
Yes, arrest me. Arrest all of us.
I'm warning you.
I have seen you before, in the plaza, with your children. I have heard them ask you, why are the island children always hungry? Your face became saddened with the cry of hunger. When your children are older, how can you face them and be proud of all of this?
What you say is true. Already my children are asking me why we, as Spaniards, must do this.
I knew you were a reasonable man.
I'll let you go this time, old man.
How long must we put up with this?
Soon there will be a change. I am on my way to join the Revolutionary Army. We meet in the mountains outside of Lares. At dawn, we attack.
Revolutionary Army?
You must go to the other villages. You must tell them the news. All must join in the fight for freedom. With me, I carry the new flag of Puerto Rico. With it, we shall lead the Revolutionary Army onto victory and freedom from Spanish rule.
You have unchained my heart. I will go and spread the word of the revolution. Down with the oppressors!
Can I come with you?
Who are you?
My name is Yolanda.
Where are you from?
My big problem now is finding out where I am.
You are in Puerto Rico, in the mountains outside of Lades, in the year of 1868. Come, this is no place for you. Come, we must get this flag to Revolutionary Army before they march.
Why is it so important?
The flag is important because it represents the desires of the Puerto Rican people to be free. The flag was designed by Ramon Betances, our leader in the fight against the Spaniards. I sewed the material together. We will ride with you.
It will be dangerous at Lares.
Are not men and women equal in this struggle?
Yes, you are right. I will get you a horse.
Mariana Bracetti is remembered to this day as one of Puerto Rico's great freedom fighters.
My name is Eddie. My vacation with my beau and Nigel in Tennessee is almost over. I wonder what we're gonna do today.
Mama G, can we go to the pet show today?
Yeah, I've got Nigel all packed and ready in his pillowcase.
Oh, that's for this afternoon. You know, Eddie, I thought that since you've been asking so much about slavery, we might visit Mrs. Pillow at the farm.
Was she a slave?
She's not that old, but she can tell us many things about slavery.
Mama G, here comes Garland.
Oh, good. We'll take him along with us.
Hi, Garland.
Hi, Eddie. May I see Nigel, please? Sure. You know where he is. Just don't take him out. Is Miss Pillow's farm very big?
She's got lots of animals.
Oh, sure. She has cows, horses, dogs, pigs.
Eddie gets a tour of Aunt Geneva's town. Southern sights and history are all around. Does adventure wait at Miss Pillow's farm? Nigel's safe at home, can't come to harm. Nigel, take a rest. Of all the animals, Eddie still loves you best. Nigel, what's ahead? Eddie's busy finding out while you're still in bed.
Hey, you're here.
I'll wake up Garland. Get up, Garland. Ooh, he must be a heavy sleeper. He even brought his own pillow.
Oh, no, he brought Nigel.
Oh, no, he didn't.
Oh, yes, he did.
Why did you bring Nigel, Garland?
Because I thought he would be lonesome.
Oh, he might scare Miss Sadie Pillow to death. Come on, Garland.
We can leave him here. We'll be okay.
Okay. Come on, kid.
Hi, Miss Pillow.
Hello, Miss Sadie. How are you? Eddie,
Miss
Pillow.
Oh,
Eddie's from New Jersey.
Oh, Eddie's from New Jersey.
Uh-huh, and we thought we'd bring him out.
Oh,
I'm glad
you did. You all be seated.
Oh, it was so nice to see you.
Where have you been, girl?
Oh, I've been expecting you. Just been there thinking that we'll come out to see you just any time, and
yes.
I couldn't find the time, so it's...
I'm so glad you did.
It must be fun to live on a farm. Do you like all your animals?
Yes, I love all of my animals dearly. But of course, none can take the place of Billy.
Who's Billy?
Oh, Billy was my favorite. He passed on some time ago. How long has it been, daughter?
Nearly a year.
I'm sorry.
We never did know what was wrong with him. We don't know whether he drank polluted water, or tripped the mouth rot, or what.
Is he a chicken?
Oh, no, honey, no, dear. Billy was... Daughter, were you going to get Billy and bring him out here so they can see him?
You mean he's here?
Yes, Billy's here. I loved him dearly. He was a favorite of mine. Oh, now, this is Billy.
It's a snake. It's pickled.
Preserved.
My word.
But, Geneva, do you think Miss Sadie would like to see Nigel?
Well, Eddie, since I've seen Billy, I'm sure she would.
I have a pet boa named Nigel. Would you like to see him?
Well, sure. That sounds interesting. Where is he?
He's in the car. What, when you get him?
Yes, I'd be glad to see him.
Okay.
But you all like to have some lemonade. I do about to make some for you.
I'll help you too, Miss Sadie.
Nigel's gone.
Gone? Where to?
Garland is gone too.
He's gone from the car, and so is the pillowcase.
Oh,
come on, kids. Let's go near the barn and see if we can
find it. This way. Don't worry.
Do you think where are you going? Where's Nigel?
He's lost on the farm.
Were you going to look for him?
Well, let's go together, dear. I'd like for you to go with me.
Not in here,
Nigel.
Just a bunch of water. What's this house? The shed where the cows are going.
That's where he stripped tobacco.
As they will ever find him, because you know, see, there's a big tobacco patch there, and snakes like tobacco. Did you know that?
Yeah.
Oh, yes, they like tobacco.
See anything?
Look, Nigel's taking a bath.
Hey, everybody, we found him.
I'm glad he didn't fall in the well.
Do you have a well?
Yes. A well was dug here by the slaves. And my grandfather was one of them.
He was a slave?
Yes. But after the emancipation, all of this land was given to him. But before that, this land served as a passageway by the slaves that were going from Alabama to Mississippi.
Escaping? Yeah, that was called the Underground Railway.
And they used to hide right here in all these bushes that you see around here. They would hide.
You know what? Folk used to slip food from behind those cabins back there.
Slaves helping other slaves. That's survival.
Yes.
Come on, everybody. Let's go in and have some lemonade.
Oh, you know what? But I think I'll get me a boy. They seem to be so spunky. And I think I'll call him Billy the Second. I'm so glad that we found him. I was so afraid that he would fall in the well or get in that big tobacco field down there. You know, we never would have found him.
This is Woody the Spoon, and I'm always alert for something special to make for dessert. But your meal comes first, so don't eat too fast. That's right, we're saving the sweet part for last. There's a dessert Southern folks make with pride. It's made by two cultures that live side by side. They make pecan pie luscious and sweet, and food's just one place where cultures meet. You'll need an adult, as you well know, and I'll tell you what to get, so get ready to go. 3 eggs, and that's a fact, 1 teaspoon of vanilla extract. cup of corn syrup, the dark kind, is best. One cup of pecans, halved or chopped, I'd suggest. 1/4 cup of sugar and salt, just a pinch. That's all we need. It's really a cinch. Now break the eggs and put them in a bowl. Mix them all together. That's the goal. Add syrup, salt, and vanilla extract. Then sugar and pecans go into your act. Pour it into an unbaked pie crust, please. Put it in the oven at 350 degrees. When the pecans have formed a crust on top, after 50 minutes, it's time to stop. You can wait till it's cold or you can eat it hot. Then add whipped cream and see what you've got. Either way you eat this pecan pie, you are gonna praise its flavor to the sky. Oh my goodness, it's good. Southern pecan pie!
All about.